There are two sessions at today's symposium. And each session is composed of one keynote address and one panel discussion. Now, I'd like to introduce the keynote speaker, panelist, and the moderator. First of all, I'd like to introduce Dr. Mari Erika Pangestu, Professor of University of Indonesia. Please come. And panelist Dr. Gary Hufbauer, Peterson Institute, resident Jones Senior Fellow. Tansri Datu Dr. Rebecca Fatima Santamaria, Chief Senior Fellow. Dr. Yose Rizal Zambi, Head of Economic Department of Center for Strategic and International Studies, CSIS, English. Dr. Shujiro Urata, the President of ELIA and Professor of Waseda University. The moderator is Dr. Han Kim, Senior Research Fellow of Singapore Institute of International Affairs and chairman of the Council of the Advisory Council of ELIA.
Thank you very much. Good morning. Welcome to the first inaugural international symposiums, this new normal economic integrations the session New Normal and East Asia Economic Integration. So the organizer has carefully identified and looked out the possible speakers, keynote speakers, and the four panelists. They will follow from the presentation from the keynote speakers. It is a very complex and new topics. It's not easy, but we have the organizers have carefully identified, and they are the right person at the right places. So this the keynote speaker, as has been announced, is the Professor Dr. Mari Pangestu. So the details of it is in your publication distributed to the participants, but it is sufficient to say that she is the right person at the right place to give this topic. So the proceedings of the this international symposium will be based like in the Davos symposium forum. So hopefully, over time, this new normal will evolve into old normal. So this international symposium will evolve into Jakarta Forum. So we have very privileged and honored to invite Professor Dr. Mari Pangestu to give us 15 minutes of the topic on the new normal and the impact on trade and investment in East Asia. Please.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, friends, good morning. It's a pleasure for me to provide the, I'm not sure it's a keynote, but the setting for this morning's session. We are going to be talking about the new normal and what that means for East Asia, especially in the context of economic integration. So let me just, in 30 seconds, describe to you 3 decades of economic integration in East Asia that has happened in the past, from 1990 to 2014, where we have seen East Asian intra-regional trade share go up from 45% to 55%. At the same time, while European integration was high, it remained flat, and North American integration through NAFTA went up and then went down and remained flat. And in East Asia as well as Southeast Asia, we see an increased intra-regional trade share. And all this has happened in the context of a very conducive and open world economy, with advanced economies pushing for openness, increased commitments in the international commitments like the WTO. We had the ASEAN Free Trade Agreement, and then followed by a deepening to the ASEAN Economic Community. And we also had APEC at the same time. And bold unilateral liberalization and reforms happened in that context of international commitments during the 80s, 90s, and into the 2000 period. That's kind of what we call maybe the old normal, or the good old days, or whatever you want to call it. But today, we want to talk about the new normal. Yeah? The world has changed dramatically, as we all know, since the global financial crisis, and especially in the last 2 years. So that there's this new normal out there that the world is in, and the question is, how should Indonesia, how should East Asia, how should ASEAN respond? The response cannot be business as usual, because it is new normal. The term new normal actually was coined firstly when, after the global financial crisis, one of the responses was, as you will recall, was monetary stimulus, where the interest rates fell even to negative territory. And new normal actually meant coming back to normal levels of interest rate. That was the first use of new normal. But now we have taken it to mean many things that are really describing the external situation and the changing ways of trade and investment that is happening in the world today, which requires us to respond in a different way. It's challenges, but it's also opportunities. This is what I want to emphasize. So just very, very briefly, what does this new normal look like? One of the characteristics of this new normal is slower trade growth. And it is perhaps not just cyclical, but also structural. Prior to the global financial crisis, trade grew at 2 to 3 times the rate of growth of the world economy. After the global financial crisis, the trade growth fell to being about the same, and in 2016 was the lowest trade growth, they say, since the 1930s recession. It grew at below world economic growth at 1.9%. World economic growth was slightly below 3% at the time. So this is a fundamental change in trade, which trade had been kind of the engine of growth. Now, structurally speaking, partly because of the slowdown in the world economy, partly because of the China slowdown, but if you look at the analysis that's behind these numbers, the large drop is related to the very large drop in investment, which is in a way related to the global financial crisis, but it's not just the global financial crisis. It's also related to the maturation of the global value chain. You know, this region grew with production networks, with production being fragmented and in between the different Asian countries, and then being produced and exported out to external markets outside of East Asia. That was kind of the model of development in the 80s, 90s, and even into 2000. And then it started evolving and changing, where more was being produced in more locations, and increased localization, especially in China. More was being produced domestically rather than being imported from outside. But what you're seeing is changing in location, and the increase in fragmentation of global value chain, which is not just about goods, but also about services. So services trade actually was more resilient than goods trade. And that is partly because of the increased fragmentation and possibility of outsourcing services that is being made possible because of technology. And that global value chains are no longer about, okay, I'm going to make machinery here, I'm going to make engine here. It's more now about clustering around tasks, whether it's R&D, whether it's assembly. It's clustering of global value chain around tasks rather than production of certain things or services. And the other component of that drop in global trade, as we saw, was policy uncertainty, especially in the last 2 years. Increased protectionism. After the global financial crisis, you will remember there was already a lot of anti-globalization reactions, the 99% versus the 1% Occupy Wall Street, etc., etc., and playing out also in Europe, and to a lesser extent, to a much lesser extent in our part of the world. But in the last 2 years, especially last year, we had a number of shocks, as you know. We had Brexit, we had the US elections, and you can see the sharp increase in the blue line and then the drop in the trade growth. It's one of the factors, not the only factor. And it is more about the policy uncertainty. You know, we still don't know what's going to happen after Brexit. We don't know if actually what will happen after Trump, even though we know that from the rhetoric. Gary will explain more about that later. And then the last thing about the new normal is the technological change. This very, very rapid rate of technological change, which is called the fourth industrial revolution by some. It's not just the digital economy, but there's, you know, this is kind of more the positive. We don't know whether it's positive or negative or net positive or net negative news yet. The impact of technology with e-commerce, increasing trade, with automation, with robotics, with increased productivity, increased innovation on the other hand. So these are still some of the challenges that all of us will be facing in the years to come. And I think the scary thing is that it's changing very, very quickly, very, very rapidly. I mean, for us in Indonesia, the impact of the digital economy in the last, just in the last 3 years, I would say, is just phenomenal. And I think most of us who are from Indonesia will appreciate that. So that's kind of the new normal in a nutshell. What is the message that we have been talking about? Yesterday we had a workshop to discuss many of these issues. I'm just giving you a summary of what we discussed yesterday. And I have been participating in many fora in the last 12 months. And you know, we talk a lot about the doom and gloom, about that rise in protectionism, the policy uncertainty, especially coming from Europe and the US. But there is actually more optimism in Asia because we're still growing. We still remain relatively open. Yes, we have a rhetoric that is anti-globalization, and protectionism, but by and large, I think we still remain open. So optimism comes from Asia. The hope comes from Asia. So that East Asian growth, which contributed probably about 2/3 to global growth, and its continued economic integration that has occurred since the last 3 decades, should continue as the new tailwind, just like the ship you see there, that's the new tailwind going towards a more continued openness of the world economy. And East Asian economic integration, whether in the economic sense that, you know, it happens because of market-driven integration or because of regional agreements, is what we need to push forward as the tailwind. So just to remind you the alphabet soup, some of you, those of you who are trade economists will know when I say TPP, RCEP, AEC, but not all of you will remember what they are. But this is the regional agreements or cooperation that exists in the region today. Don't forget APEC, which is the basis of FTAAP, that's 21 economies, which was created, APEC was created, remember, to prevent a line being drawn down the Pacific. In the 90s, that's how we envisage APEC. It's linking Asia and North America and Latin America. And then we have ASEAN, of course, which has existed since 1967. We're going to be 50 years old this year. It started with the ASEAN Free Trade Agreement, which is just trading goods, and then evolved into the ASEAN Economic Community 2015. Now we're into ASEAN Economic Community 2025. And we have the regional East Asia Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, the RCEP, which is made up of the ASEAN plus one FTAs, which includes China, Korea, Japan, India, Australia, and New Zealand. And really, this is where the East Asian economic integration, the next level of East Asian economic integration should come from. So just let me now conclude with six responses or six messages about East Asia that we need to emphasize and discuss and see how this will be really the response that is needed for the new normal. There are a lot of challenges, as we saw in the story about the new normal, but challenges are also opportunities. And so this is really how East Asia can continue to capture the opportunities which will make East Asia grow, and the countries in East Asia grow, and it is also contributing to global growth. Because East Asia is still growing on average at 6%. India, Philippines are growing at 7%. Some of the CLNV countries are growing at 8%. And Indonesia is growing at 5%. So we are still the highest growth region in the world. And given the new normal, investment is a key. So getting your investment climate right, having investment in your agreements and creating certainty, creating attractiveness for attracting investment and so on, and the importance of services. These are the two areas, new areas if you like, where domestic reforms and regional agreements need to pay attention to. Second, as I emphasized earlier, there's this headwind not yet a rejection, but a retreat from globalization, from advanced economies such as Europe and the US. They used to be the tailwind that pushed and created this conducive environment in which East Asia grew. So now that tailwind is no longer there, who's going to provide the tailwind? We would like to argue that it should come from East Asia and from some of it also from East Asia, continued East Asian economic integration. Openness has been and continues to be important for East Asia. You know, if you look at all the numbers, reduction in poverty and growth and development in East Asia, it was based on openness. And it also shaped the domestic reforms. So moving forward, we need to do more in East Asian economic integration. And here the big question is the collective leadership that needs to come from Asia. You know, TPP in a way was a US-led integration economic agreement and comprehensive economic agreement. RCEP, AEC is obviously ASEAN. RCEP, who is the leader? It is really should be ASEAN-led plus collectively with other Asian countries. So completing the RCEP negotiations this year is a very important signal. Third, the evolution of global value chains that I described very, very briefly today. If you really want to know more about it, read all the research coming out of area, a lot of research there. To summarize it, I use this sentence, old things happen in new places, and new things happen in old places. In other words, as you become less competitive because of higher costs or higher labor costs, that part of the production moves to another place. But you don't stop being part of the global value chain. You move up and you do more value added, you do more innovation, you are getting into services and so on and so forth. So the new agreements, the reforms that countries need to do, new agreements, whether it's the AEC or the RCEP, need to accommodate the old and the new. The old is still about market access, but now it's less about tariffs, but more about non-tariff measures and what's behind the border. And accommodate also the new issues, whether it's investment services, IP, movement of people. These are the new issues and new rules that must also be in a renewed trade agreement to respond to the new normal. Fourth, technology and creative disruption, which is a very challenging, still a moving target, if you like, where you have new production technologies which are driven by data transfers, like 3D printing, rather than goods. So it's being driven by data transfers, not really so much about, you know, where is it most the cheapest place to produce anymore, but you can just send the program through the program through the internet, the specification, and you can print it out with a 3D printer. And new ways of selling goods and services, which is the e-commerce component and so on. These pose challenges and opportunities for national policies. You know, also you can have financial technology applications in there. The movement of the innovation is faster than regulations or regulators can keep up with. And these need to be reflected in national policies as well as in trade agreements. And you should take advantage of the fact that technology can contribute to inclusiveness, because it really, as you know, with fintech, financial inclusion, e-commerce is the space for SMEs and so on and so forth. Okay, I have. That's what the number one to number four is what we need to do. This is the end goal. This is what we call what the economists and what we think should and we hope would happen. But the politics of it all to make it happen is the next two slides. One is the domestic politics. We have to recognize that it's a different world. Part of the old, good old days, maybe not the good old days, but part of the old normal was everything was what we call low politics, top down. Yes, you have to liberalize, you have to do reform. Now we are in a different world. We have democracy in many of the East Asian countries. We have increasing voice and noise. And of course, we have to heed the warning signs that has happened in Europe, in the US, and so on, about the perception or reality of the lack of distribution impact of globalization and openness. And how we should do that, I think the end goal is still the same, broad-based development, having markets and ensuring fair trade. And fair trade here means making sure you have contestable markets and rules to ensure the fair trade. And you should also focus on how economic trade agreements of today, they're normally now called comprehensive economic partnerships. So the P is important, the partnership, the capacity building and economic technical cooperation that are in the trade agreements to ensure more equitable distribution between and within countries. And of course, specific and complementary policies outside of trade policy that will help you to have adjustment to more competition, more openness. There will be the second session will address this actually. Whether it's infrastructure, education, training, and skill development, or social safety nets, and also making having effective capacity building within trade agreements. And then finally, the political leadership and how to make sense of what I said as the shared and collective leadership in the region for pushing this tailwind and you know, fight this anti-globalization, anti-immigration and nationalism, and in a way the decline of the belief in multilateral institutions like the WTO. The US has signaled that they will go bilateral or even unilateral. So these are things that are headwinds that Asia should step up to its task of being the tailwind. And AEC and RCEP at the moment, plus maybe Pacific Alliance in Latin America, are the only games in town. And we like to emphasize that RCEP is not a China-led initiative. It was born in 2011 by ASEAN. So ASEAN needs, but ASEAN needs to play a role. ASEAN needs to take a leadership role. And the other panelists today will be talking about this issue of leadership. And China can play a leadership role within RCEP as well as in the capacity building with its Belt and Road, with its AIIB initiatives. Japan, which has also had a very strong capacity building overseas development assistance program, should also be can take a leadership. The question out there is the role of India. I'll just put it as a question. What should be and what could be the role of India? And finally, we should not leave the US out. We should continue to be engaged with the US. And we should, the world is going to be bilateral, as we know, but we should try to make it more regional, more wider cooperation. And there are institutions within our East Asia context, such as the East Asia Summit, which includes India and the US. and APEC, and Russia, and APEC, which includes the 21 economies, and there's also the G20. So how to ensure that we continue, East Asia continues to engage with the US is, I think, also another important part of the political leadership when we talk about it in the regional context. I'll end there and hope that the panelists will definitely go into more detail into some of these points, and I hope that we can have a good and interesting discussion after that. Thank you very much.
Well, exceeding 5 minutes, 20 minutes, but it's really very, very fruitful, productive, and insightful. So, thank you very much for providing the intellectual firepower and practical policy for us, what needs to be done on the ground. I think these are all very useful. As I said, that Professor Dr. Maripan is the right person and at the right place to speak on this very complex and topical subject. And it's not easy. The organizer has given 5 minutes to speak and said, you know, it's much easier to speak 20 minutes rather than 5 minutes. But for this very experienced and authority in their field specialist, it is possible. That's why we do the impossible for the possibility. Okay. So the first one, we would like to invite Dr. Gary Hartbauer from the Patterson Institute of International Economics in Washington. So he's at the ground zero. So he's at the ringside and watching the blow-by-blow accounts of President Trump and his administration on a daily basis in Washington, D.C. So as you know, the Patterson Institute for International Economics is very well-known, well-established, and also very closely monitored by all, not only in the U.S., but all over the world. So I think he is very appropriate. But he will give us, and we expect the ringside blow-by-blow accounts on what President Trump and his administration would, the underlying dynamics, internal dynamics, and what would be implications to the regions on trade and investment. Dr. Gary Hartbauer, please.
Well, thank you very much. It's great to be away from Washington for a few days and enjoy home in Chicago. So there has been a revolution, as you know, in thinking in Washington with the election of President Trump. The old agenda on the international economy, which lasted for 70 years from President Truman to President Obama, had important features which, let me just quickly summarize. The lower barriers to trade all around, including U.S. barriers, have multilateral agreements, starting, of course, with the GATT, but then going to the World Trade Organization, to have bilateral and regional agreements when multilateral seemed to be pausing or halting, as it did after the Uruguay round, to welcome foreign direct investment, both outward from the United States to the rest of the world, and inward into the United States. That was the old agenda. Okay, now we have President Trump, and we have a new agenda and new principles. So I'm going to just briefly talk over the principles that we can discern from what President Trump has said in his tweets and what his advisors have said. Firstly, yes, he likes free trade, but it has to be fair trade. Now that sounds kind of like we like mothers and we like apple pie, but for Trump, it's much more than that. For him, fair trade means balanced trade, which means that partner countries should not have trade surpluses with the United States. The United States should not have trade deficits with them. If we have a deficit with a country, as we do with many countries, it was a bad deal negotiated by inept bureaucrats. So that's the core meaning of fair trade. Related to that is his concept which I call, this is not his words, but I call mirror image reciprocity, which means that if another country is charging taxes on U.S. exports to that country, notably value-added taxes, and is rebating its taxes on its exports to the United States, that's unfair. That's unfair. And if another country has higher tariffs on a particular product, whether it be motorcycles or autos or chemicals or anything, then the United States has tariffs on its products. That's unfair. So mirror image reciprocity. The barriers that we have, you should have no higher if you are a trading partner. The third principle is hire Americans and buy America. Well, you could say hire Indonesians, buy Indonesia. Hire Indian, buy Indian. A lot of countries do this. But for the United States, there is an old, very old law that dates back to the Great Depression of Buy America, but Trump has given it new vigor and new force. So what does that mean? It means that government procurement at all levels, federal, state, local, should do everything possible to buy products made in America. Now that's a big extension of an old idea, big extension. Hire America, what does that mean? That means, as explained by Peter Navarro, what it is, AIDS. We don't like foreign investment anymore. We don't want U.S. firms to go abroad and invest, because if they invest abroad, in his mind, they're not investing in the United States. One-for-one substitute. So they're not hiring Americans. What else? Supply chains. We should shorten supply chains. And what does that mean? Don't buy products that are part component of, you know, complex machinery, trucks, autos, electronics, which are made abroad. Make it all in at home. Now those are very, very radical ideas, very new ideas. It portends a big change in U.S. trade policy with the world, and I'll just leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Gary. You just fit 5 minutes. So he's very precise, and I think very much also he's providing the internal dynamics. What is the drivers behind the underlying principle of Trump and his administration. I think the implication to it will can come back in the second round. Now, the second panelist, also very authoritative, she used to be inside the government as the Secretary General of the Ministry of Trade and Industry in Malaysia. So chief negotiators in RCEP and TPP, so she knows the inside. Now she's outside, she's trying to get inside again by helping area and this international symposium. So we look forward to very much of her insight and her policy prescriptions of what we should do beyond, as Professor Dr. Malik Mong has given the prescription to go forward. So I would like to invite also Tan Sri, Dr. Rebecca, to provide them within 5 minutes. I know you can do it. Please.
My focus would essentially be on the phase that we're in right now with the RCEP negotiations, the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership negotiations. As Marie has talked about, the phases in ASEAN integration, we went from very looking at ourselves, ASEAN internally, the free trade agreement, the investment agreements, the services agreements, and then we moved into the ASEAN Plus One agreement. Now it's the next phase, which is integrating the Plus One FTAs. So with RCEP, you're actually giving a stronger face to the East Asia mechanism.
the East Asia region. And very important to remember that the RCEP is ASEAN-led. ASEAN's role really is bringing together a diverse group of countries. And more importantly is the inclusion of India. India is not included in TPP. It's not included in a number of agreements. So RCEP is an opportunity for us to work more closely with India. But India must decide how it wants to, you know, how it wants to be a team player, the role that it will play in East Asia integration. Similarly, China, Korea, and Japan have been working together for a number of years to formulate an agreement among themselves, but they struggle to find common ground. ASEAN has the opportunity, it has brought them together in a very practical way to deepen economic integration through RCEP. So we have the challenge of ASEAN. When I say we, I mean ASEAN. ASEAN has the challenge of curating all these different and disparate views with an outcome that could work for all of us in the region. Our principles are simple. We are pragmatic, we have open regionalism, and more importantly, we are inclusive. So the opportunities for us are just amazing, but we need to strike while the iron is hot, as they say, and recall why we're doing what we're doing. It's important for us to remember that what we're doing today is not about today, but it's about the next 50 years. So where do we see ourselves, the East Asia region, in the next 50 years? So that's where we should be heading and looking, and not negotiate it through this narrow lens of what's in it for me today. So the question is really about why we got together in the first place. We have all these plus one FTAs. So one of the main reasons we got together was to ensure that we manage this noodle bowl effect. Each of the FTAs has its own rules. So if you're exporting to these six countries, you have six sets of rules to follow. So if we bring all the parties together, it makes sense. It makes business sense to bring all these parties together, so we have one set of rules. So that's a challenge in itself, bringing together and formulating one set of rules that apply across the region. But if we succeed, and I'm sure we will succeed, the opportunities are immense for the region and for businesses to grow in this region. The three important aspects of RCEP. One is market access. But market access is just one part of the agreement. You have rules and regulations which we're looking at to make sure that, you know, there is coherence across the region. And the third part is the cooperation and trade facilitation aspect. That is equally important in this sort of agreement, because through that you bring in the SMEs, the small and medium enterprises, to ensure that they come up to speed and can take advantage of the opportunities that this agreement is creating. So that is the inclusive portion of RCEP. Challenges, there are many. Lessons that we can learn, we learned when we were negotiating the TPP, there were a lot of lessons that we learned in the process. Not least is the investor-state dispute settlement. If you recall, there was a lot of noise around that aspect. Folks were saying that the TPP was about big business taking advantage of our markets. It was allowing big business to sue governments. And there was some truth to that if you look at the history of the suits, the lawsuits that happened after NAFTA. But what the TPP, the negotiators managed to do was to come up with an agreement which managed the frivolous or prevented frivolous suits against the state. So a lot of new rules, as it were made, were formulated through the TPP. So not something that you want to dismiss so easily, you know. So one would think that when you look at the TPP and with Trump's position on the TPP, I say don't throw away the baby with the bathwater. There are so many good aspects that were negotiated in the TPP, which we can then transfer into RCEP. So things to consider. I'm rushing because I've got 5 minutes. So those are things, important lessons that we learned in the TPP to be considered in RCEP. RCEP negotiators, especially those from ASEAN, also need to balance ambition with flexibilities, because we have in RCEP LDCs, we didn't have them in the TPP. So how do you make sure you integrate the least developed countries into this agreement so that they too benefit? So of course the more advanced members have very high ambition and they want all these disciplines and rules, but how do you ensure that the less developed members in this agreement can benefit even as we look to upgrade these rules and regulations? You know, so just let me say that in the end, RCEP is an opportunity for us. It is not a threat. And as Asia continues to grow, we need to keep up this momentum and have the focus, which is now fading away from the US, to increasingly come to this region. And let's give them a reason to continue to look at us, to continue to invest in Asia and East Asia specifically, and ASEAN in particular. Thank you.
Thank you. The third panelist, he's not from the government. He's from outside, but if you want to take Indonesia from the director of heads of the economic department of CSIS, Center for Strategic International Studies in Jakarta. So if you want to know more Indonesia, Indonesia is the coordinator for ASEAN, for ASEAN ASEAN. So it's very important to know the Indonesian position and what is the thinking in the government's public policies and all this. So there are very few persons who know very well, except Dr. Pangestu, who knows very well. But we invite Dr. Yose to give us 5 minutes from what you are thinking on the Indonesian position on ASEAN and the trade and investment. Please.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Hagelin. I think I might say first that perhaps it's not the really Indonesian position that I would like to talk about here, but rather about how Indonesia perhaps also can contribute to the East Asian integrations. And I'd like to say first that the benefits of East Asian integration that the, Professor Mari already mentioned is quite abundant. And then we can see it clearly in many countries in East Asia, including also in Indonesia. Yeah, but like for example, the trade has multiplied several times in many countries in East Asia, including also in Indonesia. The poverty has been reduced, partly because of the trade activities also and economic growth. But unfortunately, the understandings of this on this issue remain poorly understood. Because as you can see, many countries in East Asia still feel ambivalent about the greater integration process in the region. They still think that unless they really get the concrete benefits such as market access to other countries, then they feel reluctant to go for greater integrations. This is, I think, so we need to talk about that, how to make the knowledge more, knowledge on the benefits of integrations can be better understood by all government officials and also all stakeholders. But I think that kind of things need to be set aside a little bit, given the current situation that Prof. Mary already described this morning. Because I think this is the time for East Asian countries to become champions of integration. Because of that, benefit that they enjoy already, this is it's actually a time to pay tribute to the integration, to the globalization, and become more active in leading the globalization. ASEAN as well, and especially also to Indonesia, as one of the initiators in the integration, I think Indonesia should also play more active roles in that integration process. Not only that, not only because it already enjoyed all the benefit, but because also the consequences of having restrictive trade policy is quite imminent, actually. Like for example, let me cite a statistic about Indonesian export. Around 50% of Indonesian export to China is actually embedded into Chinese export to other countries. So, like 50%, a half of Indonesian export is basically would be exported to the other part of the world. Then, even if Indonesia is currently not the Trump's target list, as Gary mentioned, still we will feel the consequences if the restrictive trade policy will be implemented to China. And that kind of consequences is unbearable. So I think in my opinion, this is really a right time for ASEAN, for East Asian countries, including also Indonesia, to make bold statement to the world that integration is the only direction for the future. Thank you very much.
Symptom that we find in the United States or Europe, but throughout the world. So we have to avoid you know, growing protectionist policy. That's the first. The second point is on Japan's vision on TPP. Prime Minister Abe, for him, TPP was very important. Part of his Abenomics, Abe economics, which consists of famous three arrows. And the third arrow is called growth strategy. And TPP was very important part of growth strategy. So now that TPP does not look like it's going to be enacted in the near future, we have to think about alternatives. I still like to stick to TPP. It's not completely dead yet, I don't think. I hope not. It's possible that Mr. Trump will change his mind. It's possible. Maybe not probable, but it's possible. So just in case if he changes his mind, we have to maybe keep TPP alive, just in case he changes. And also, as Rebecca told us, benefits or a good point about TPP. So you know, TPP can be a model for other FTAs. And so a TPP should be kept alive, in my view. But at the same time, Japan should make every effort to contribute to the conclusion of RCEP and also Japan-EU FTA and China-Japan-Korea. CJK-FTA. And to do so, we need a strong political will. And the question is, how can we get that strong political will? Leaders need support from the general public, maybe support from academics, support from business and stakeholders. So a forum like this is very important. Get the to realize the benefits of RCEP, benefits of trade liberalization and so on. So I think it is very important for us to realize the benefits of free trade and investment. And I hope this forum will contribute to that effect. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Urata, for your insight of the Japanese perspectives on what to move forward, you know, beyond the present circumstances of the international trade and investment and the regional integration. Now, because we started late, 20 minutes late, so we all together we have about 1 hour 20 minutes, so we're still on time. So we, after hearing the keynote speaker and then the four panelists, I think we are very much aware of the issues, what need to be done to go forward, to be the champions, to be Japan first, but global and region first are also important, equally important. So we would like to open the floor. About three, four questions, but make it the questions short and right to the point and identify yourself so that we can maximize the time available to us. May I invite the floor to ask any questions to the keynote speaker, to the panelists?
I'm from the University of Indonesia, recognized me Susilo. And I want to ask you about the title of this symposium, which is Normal Integration and Inequality. I'm trying to ask you whether this is not only for TPP, but I want to ask about the 2020 when there's a possibility of trade integration of Asian and the European Union. Because I heard from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, we are going to open at the year of 2020. Is it still valid or not? I don't know. But my worry is about the fact that after MEA, Indonesia, the export of Indonesia is this, was this decreasing in last year. And the export of China to Indonesia was increasing 125%. So my question, what is the thing that we have to prepare concerning the inequality that already obvious from that fact? Thank you very much.
Shall we collect all the questions and then we respond to you? Thank you, Ibu Susilo.
I would like to congratulate Dr. Mari Bansu for her excellent keynote address. I would like to ask her this question where she left in terms of discussing CJK, and you had this point in terms of what would be the role for India. And I wanted to ask you this question coming from New Delhi and Sachin Chaturvedi from RIS. I wanted to ask you this. Thank you.
There's this new report that the Asia Society Policy Institute has just issued. It's edited by Wendy Cutler, a seasoned USTR officer. She's saying that the legacy of the TPP should be the following, that standards should be incorporated into other regional deals. How do you see this materializing? Thank you very much.
I only want to know about the opinion of Mr. Rata about the future of the TPP after Trump. What's your opinion about the after this? What should we do? What's the position of ASEAN countries like Indonesia and Malaysia with the future of the TPP after this condition? And second, I just want to know what your you can elaborate the future of TPP and what is the position of ASEAN countries in there after this condition, after the Trump elected.
Thank you.
The current chargé d'affaires at the New Zealand mission to ASEAN. My question is for the panel, but following up on a comment from Dr. Hufbauer, you said you characterized the Trump administration's ideas as new ideas on trade and radical ideas. To me, they sounded like old ideas that had been done in the past. And in light of that, and bearing in mind the statement that those who don't understand history are doomed to repeat it, I just wondered if you had any thoughts on if there is follow through from the Trump administration on these ideas, what the implications are likely to be for this region. Thank you.
This is Tim Young from Jakarta Foreign Correspondents Club and also from China Coming to Lee. And my question is, on Sunday, the Chinese government just officially released the working plan for 2017. And it was the first time the Chinese government used the anti-globalization to describe the current international trade circumstance. So what might be the feedback from Indonesia and also from the ASEAN partners? Thank you.
Can I
have a question to you, Radha-san? Because you mentioned Japan in the context of the TPP and all that, but you didn't mention ASEAN. So I want to know Japan's position on ASEAN.
Japan is, of course, more with the RCEP as well. One of the established policy is to use these FTAs, the mega FTAs, as a step toward Japan's economic recovery. So, among several mega FTAs, he puts most emphasis on TPP, but he also is RCEP, Japan EU FTA, CJK FTA, as important. And coming back to this point about the TPP minus United States, what I wanted to say is that Japan is still hoping, or at least Abe is still hoping, that Mr. Trump will change his mind. or TPP, although it's, I think, maybe not so likely, but TPP, even without the United States, which is TPP 11, I think, this is not Prime Minister Abe's view, but in my view, TPP 11 should be pursued, hopefully by inviting other countries such as South Korea, Philippines, Indonesia, of course, and Thailand, which showed interest in joining TPP last year. So I'm still hopeful that TPP can provide a very important positive platform for this region.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for your response. How about the one in New Zealand's Charles the first question on these? Okay,
you can respond to the questions as well.
Yeah. One of the questions raised was the face ASEAN in the face of this anti-globalization movement. I think to a large extent, a number of ASEAN member states are open economies. And therefore, it is in our interest to keep the markets open. And engaging in agreements such as ASEAN would keep our markets open, help us focus. Well, I agree with Jose when he said that, you know, because of the way global value chains are structured, you cannot just close your door to one market. It's going to impact all of us. So it is in our interest to keep our markets going. And with regards to standards, I think that's one of the things that we have included, one of the takeaways from the TPP that we brought into the ASEAN negotiations. We're looking at standards. And streamlining standards, not so much harmonizing them, but streamlining them, finding coherence across the standards and regulations among the 16 members of ASEAN. So there's so many lessons that we can learn from the process of having gone through the TPP, some of the aspects of disciplines and rules and regulations. Those are valid and should necessarily be taken on board when we look at ASEAN as we deepen the negotiations in ASEAN.
Okay, thank you. particularly the first from the UAE.
Okay, I think Ibu Nuni, in my opinion, your questions, apologies for that, but I must say that your questions illustrate what I mean by the knowledge on benefit of integration is poorly understood. Apologize for that, but that shows us on how many people sees that the benefits of integration can be reduced into only trade balances, how the exports should be increased, import should be reduced. That's, I think that kind of things have to be changed. Let me show you also one CSIS study. We did a survey to 500 firms 3 years ago, and then we asked the questions, what is the impact of trade integration and trade agreements to your firm's activities? Mostly, majority say negatively. Yeah. But when we ask about what is their ability to source inputs, what is their opportunity to increase their export, they respond positively. So there is this big gap between the real benefit of integrations and also the grand narrative of negative impact of the trade agreements and trade, economic integrations. I think this is our job. Dr. Henglin, Bu Mari, also Professor Murata, to send a clearer message about benefit of integration and also the consequences of having more restrictive, more protectionist situations in the future. I think. I hope that answers the questions.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you for your response. We have not responded on the CJK issues, the one that raised by
Let me take on the question of the role of India. ASEAN went through quite a long process of negotiating the FTA with India. And we were quite successful. I think at the end of the day, it was an agreement which benefited both sides. I know that if you talk to friends from India, they would look at the balance and say that it was more in favor of ASEAN than India. But I think that's the nature of the business, because India is more services dependent than goods. But having said that, in RCEP, I think there's a lot of opportunity for us to find that balance between merchandise and services. And that's where we like to look at India's role in being more facilitative, looking at more facilitative trade rules that would benefit benefit all the parties in the negotiations, as opposed to looking at it from a very narrow country interest perspective. That's my response to you.
Thank you, Anjali. Now, can I ask? Yes, sir. Yes.
About CJKF, some people think, or many people think that CJKF is necessary for us. No, I don't think that's the case. CJKF at least, Japan wants it to be very high level, very comprehensive. Not maybe so for us, because of this couple of reasons. So we can have RCEP included without CJKF. I think that's something, I think it's important. And just to follow up on what I said about RCEP, Japan's position on RCEP, I want to say that I'd like to see Japan more active in promoting RCEP. This is my personal view. And Japan set up a TPP kind of office to deal with TPP negotiations. Prime Minister Abe assigned Mr. Amari as a TPP minister. But we don't have RCEP minister. We don't have RCEP office. So that really shows how different attitudes for TPP versus RCEP. And I'd like to see more active participation in Japan by maybe setting up RCEP office, possibly. So that's my personal view.
Thank you for your contribution. Yes,
I'd like to raise one issue, actually, because I emphasize the better knowledge on benefits of integration. But on the other hand, I think we should also come up with a simpler integration process. The current arrangement for economic integration has become so complex that nobody understands it unless you get paid to understand the process. Like, for example, a TPP that we already discussed about TPP. It's like 600 pages with 6,000 other pages as annex. It becomes so complex. So perhaps we need to come up also with a newer way to have an integration, simpler way, and also can be understood by many people, all the stakeholders, and also for sure to be enjoyed by those stakeholders.
Okay, thank you for your
time.
I think
Japan
should have Dr. Gary Kambao has been quiet, but he's the center of the Drop
Stop.
Zero, the stock, the eye of the stock. So maybe you can tell us what would be the effect on trade investment to ASEAN and the region as a result of the President Trump's action, as you are not presented it in the initial round.
Okay, thanks very much. I want to first thank the speaker from New Zealand, who remembers her history, because she's absolutely right. These are old ideas, but they are so old that all the young people in that room don't remember them. But before I come to your question, and let me say a little bit about the restraints on President Trump. I mean, he's not quite Caesar. You know, we do have other institutions, and starting with the Congress. The Congress is very insistent that it be consulted on everything to do with trade policy. And of course, that's everything I talked about. Secondly, we have the business firms, which are quite interested in their supply chains and in our foreign investment and their imports from the world. And they are very influential with congressmen because they support financially and otherwise, you know, various senators and congressmen and so forth. And they're not going to just sit back and accept this new agenda. Finally, we have the financial markets, which are not written into the Constitution, but they are a very powerful restraint on any president. My belief is that if we went down the path that I outlined, full bore, we would soon get into a trade war with China and other countries. And I think that's a recipe for a big shock on Wall Street, which is a recipe for the president being quite unpopular. One reason he's so popular right now is that Wall Street has gone up 12% since he was elected. Now, coming to your question, Hank, on what it would mean if we go down this path for ASEAN. Well, the path is one of bilateral agreements. He likes bilateral agreements. Power relationships, obviously, speak to that. Wilbur Ross would be the chief negotiator, and what he would ask for are all kinds of measures that increase U.S. exports. That's the goal. So that would be good, increasing trade, U.S. exports. The threat is if the partner country does not take measures that would enable the U.S. to increase its exports, then we will decrease its imports into the United States. We will put some kind of restriction on, not spelled out, it wasn't the campaign, but anyway, that's the threat. So, but the first objective is to increase exports. It will start with Mexico, where we have a $60 billion trade deficit. We do not have a trade deficit with Canada. We will still have the reciprocity agenda that I mentioned with Canada, but not the trade deficit agenda. What about other countries? Well, what about specifically ASEAN? Well, the President Erie, Professor Nishimura, has written a handbook. This is out there, it's available. This is non-tariff barriers in ASEAN. You can be sure that Wilbur Ross and Robert Lighthizer will be good readers of this book if it comes to negotiating any kind of agreement in ASEAN. Because this lists, exactly, and of course the tariff levels, they can be found, just go to the WTO website. So you've got a whole list of things. We publish our own books in the United States, but it's not as detailed as this. It's a wonderful guide. Trump thanks you, Professor Nishimura. So that would be the negotiation. And the negotiation would be, if you have a trade surplus with the United States, which Indonesia does, about $10 billion, I'm told by my good friend Mark. Well, Indonesia should find ways to open its markets so the U.S. can sell at least an additional $10 billion to Indonesia before the U.S. does anything. Once Indonesia's opened its markets, then we can maybe talk about the U.S. opening its markets to some extent. And we can look in this handbook to find what Indonesia should do. Thank you.
Thank you. Well,
I know that we're running out of time. I can see he's getting nervous over there. But I think you didn't answer the question about China and the recent statement, as well as I think it was the same sentiment that President Xi Jinping expressed in Davos on anti-globalization and what should China's role be. I think China should, in the first instance, undertake its own unilateral reforms. You know, champion the openness agenda by undertaking, continuing and hopefully being a champion for the unilateral reforms. And I think within RCEP, they should play a supportive role, they should play a key role
but not the only role. I mean, there is a lot of discussion about, you know, China-led RCEP, which is not, I think, the right balance. I think we need to have a collective leadership in Asia to realize RCEP. But within that context, I think the role of China in capacity building and economic technical cooperation for regional economic integration is very crucial. And you already have the Belt and Road, and you have the AIIB. But it should be done with the context of regional connectivity, not for, you know, it should be win-win, in other words. That it should be you're building infrastructure, you're building capacity with the regional connectivity and integration in mind as a focus. And finally, I think, you know, we are all afraid of a US-China trade war of some sort. So I think as much as possible to maintain it, retain it, or contain it to, again, we do have a WTO, we have trade remedy system, we have dispute settlement, as long as we can confine it, contain it to the rules, then hopefully whatever trade war happens is not going to have too much, hopefully, spillover effect to the rest of us.
Thank you very much, Ibu Mali. That's a very, very important message. Okay. Even if there is a conflict, there is still multilateral WTO that we can somehow contain and stabilize the situation. So actually, we run out of time, and you can imagine it's very complex and very difficult, and also very interesting. You know, issues that very difficult to confine to the time limit. But again, President Nishimura from area would like to intervene. I have to give the floor to him and to say, please.
I'm very honored, Professor Kapao showed our LTM database. But I like to say one thing. This is NTF database in cooperation with ASTA. It does not mean long-time buying. That is very important. Yes, NTF has either the sanitary or environment or there are some necessary reasons. Because now the safety requirement is very increasing, so each country introduced a regulation to save the people's interest. So dramatically increased from 1,000 to 5,000 in just only 10 years. So this is where salary show the real database. So based on this database, everybody can analyze. That is our academic contribution. So this is a cooperation with ANTA, not a cooperation with WTO. WTO is now thinking of, among all NGOs, some the trade in impact. The submissions has a trade impact. That will be notification for in that kind of procedure. But this is real hard, but we are very on weak.
Thank you very much. So, Jerry, please bring more copies to Mr. Wilbur Ross in Washington, D.C. we are running out of time, but I just want to say a few words from the keynote speaker and the four panelists and all these things, a few takeaways. That I think you should remember that business as usual, that the new normal we must have cannot be business as usual. It means we must have a different mindset, different. So it means everybody must be champions and must continue the commitments. That the tailwind that Ibu Mari mentioned is actually not enough. So we have to continue to vitalize it, harmonize it, dynamize it. The any drivers of growth by only just trade and investment, probably not enough. So the GVC, the production network, all need to be vitalized, need to be maintained, and need to be energized. So another thing that is the takeaway from it is that the regional integration, the ASEP, is very, very important for ASEAN. And we should take leadership and should take the possible finalized by end of this year. And this provides the share and common leadership that is required, not just one country, but all other countries in ASEAN need to help Indonesia as the coordinator of ASEAN to move forward. And that is a very important message, and we can make a tremendous contribution arising from this international symposium. So those are the takeaways that I think we should take note of it and bring it home. Thank you again very much to the...
Thank you very much. And to the green and speakers. Please go back to the seat.